It's my honor to introduce our first speaker, Professor Colin Bale. He's well known to most gastroenterologists. He's a leader in the field of inflammatory bowel disease, first author in major trials, including the most recent CALM trial. He's a past president of the ECHO organization, president of the International Organization of Inflammatory Bowel Disease, and currently he's the director of the Helmsley IBD Center at Mount Sinai in New York, United States. Professor Colin Bale, welcome to Saudi Arabia.
Thank you so much. So it's a pleasure and honor to be invited to this meeting. This is my first time in Saudi Arabia. I hope I will come back. So I will talk, this is a kind of general talk that will, introduce a session about the new therapeutic strategies in IBD. So I will start first by talking about some challenges that we are facing in 220, and I will talk about what solutions we can think about. This is the first challenge. This is a cover picture of the special issue of gastroenterology that we published January 2017. Which actually represents something which is fascinating, which are these two waves of IBD in the world. The first one, of course, that you know, occurred in Scandinavia, Northern America in the 50s and 60s. This is this red wave. And then what we have seen is this second wave, meaning the amazing increasing incidence of IBD in countries such as Saudi Arabia, but also in Asia and so on. So this is becoming a worldwide epidemic. Sorry. So based on data that we have, we can estimate that there are approximately 5 million of people affected worldwide, 0.5% of the population in the highest prevalence regions. The rate in the rise in incidence is steep in newly industrialized countries, and still in adolescents in industrialized countries. For instance, in France, the incidence of Crohn's disease is still increasing in adolescents. And when you think about a country like China, I was with my friend Xu Ning recently, she estimated that very soon she may have more than 1.5 million cases of IBD. So this is huge. The second problem is that with the drugs that we have now, with our best drugs, we are not doing so well. This is an exercise that I have done recently, which was just to look at the pivotal trials with the biologics, adalimumab, infliximab, vedolizumab, and ustekinumab. So what I did was to look at the actual remission rate at 1 year. Because you need to remember that in all those trials, there is an induction period, and then only the responders are randomized for the maintenance period. So it doesn't reflect the reality. The reality is this. This is what you will get with these drugs. So basically between 20 and 30% of remission at 1 year. So obviously we need to do better. This is a very interesting recent review paper on population-based studies looking at the outcomes of UC. Just concentrate your attention on the center, looking at, for instance, disease activity. As you can see, the 10-year relapse is still very high, around 80%. The 10-year hospitalization, 60%. The percentage of colectomy at 10 years and 20 years is still around 10-20%, and the steroid exposure still more than 50%. So we have made progresses, but there is still a long way to go. And then there is a problem of side effects. This is the most recent data regarding the side effects of anti-TNF and combo therapy, and especially the risk of lymphoma. This is a huge French cohort of almost 200,000 patients. And you have the risk of lymphoma, all lymphoma, Hodgkin, non-Hodgkin, in all patients and patients with incidence IBD. if you look at the hazard ratio, they are all increased, mainly for azathioprine monotherapy. For enciclopramide mono, actually, it's not significant, but when you look at combo therapy, there is definitely an increased risk of lymphoma. So we are still facing side effects with these drugs. And finally, and we were just discussing that with some friends, there is a gap between what you are doing as expert in IBD and what is done in clinical practice. This is a very interesting study from Corey Siegel that he presented last year at ECHO, showing at insurance database from US. And this is what patients with Crohn disease, more than 16,000, received from the beginning, from the diagnosis on the left, up to 5 years. As you can see, 40% were started on steroids, but 35% was started on 5-ASA, which actually doesn't work in Crohn disease. And very few were started on biologics. So less than 5% were initiated on biologics. And overall, the biologic pathways as monotherapy were rare, with fewer even as combo therapy. And as you can see, as time is going by, there are still a lot of patients maintained on 5-ASA, steroids, and so on and so forth. And 63% of patients initiated on steroids were only managed with steroids. Some were on steroids for up to 10 cycles. This is a reality, and I think this is not acceptable. So I don't know how to fill this gap, but we need to teach the community. And of course, there is this huge problem of cost. This is a study coming from the Netherlands, which is called the COIN study, which has shown for the first time that the cost of IBD has shifted from surgery and hospitalizations towards the cost of biologics. If you look at the two bars on the bottom, this is Crohn disease in University Medical Center and General Hospital. The white part represents the cost of biologics. So the cost of biologics nowadays accounts for most of the cost of IBD. And this is a growing problem in many countries. So what can we do? I think we need to optimize what we have. And this is what I would like to briefly cover. We need to think about a new concept of IBD. We need to think about timing, and we'll have a special topic about when to start biologics. We need to think about this concept of treat to target, monitoring, and choosing the right patients. So I will briefly cover these five topics. So this is the right concept. This is a slide that we designed with my late friend Mark Lehmann a few years ago. In the past, we were considering Crohn's disease and UC as an intermittent disease, which is a blue line on the bottom, with flares, remission, and so on and so forth. And we were concentrating on measuring the inflammatory activity using CDAI, CDS, and CRP. But we were missing the point. These diseases are progressive diseases, like rheumatoid arthritis. And as soon as you have a flare, there is accumulation of bowel damage, leading to stricture, fistula, and eventually surgery, which is the ultimate damage. So this is how we need to think about Crohn's. It's a progressive disease. And the goal of treatment is not so much to treat symptoms. Of course, you need to treat symptoms. But the new goal that we have is to stop or to slow down the progression and damage, and this red line, which is disability associated with bowel damage. And this is my ultimate goal. So this is a new concept that you need to keep in mind. So what about timing? I will not talk too much about that because we'll have a special lecture about when to start. But there is this concept which is key. There is a window of opportunity, like in rheumatoid arthritis. There is accumulating data, and we will soon publish meta-analysis on that, showing that earlier treatment with biologics is true for anti-TNF, is true for vedolizumab, is more effective than late treatments. There is this window of opportunity where we need to catch the disease if you want to block progression. This is a post-hoc analysis of the SONIC data and just concentrate on the last line, and you will see this amazing data when we compare azathioprine, infliximab and combo in early patients, meaning less than 18 months disease duration, no complications. Look at the data with combo. They are striking. 65% of patients in deep remission, clinical remission, endoscopic healing, normalization of CRP. These are the best data ever observed in Crohn's disease. So timing means also to think, and we just discussed about that during the previous session, when to stop. And my answer is, I don't know. We have some data showing that even if you stop, for instance, an anti-TNF after several years of remission, the risk of relapse is quite high. But this was not a randomized study. So this is an ongoing study that we are doing with ECHO and CCFA and the JETED, which is called the SPARE trial, where we are randomizing patients on combo therapy to continuing combo, stopping infliximab or stopping the anti-metabolites. And when a patient will relapse, we'll explore a second concept, which is a concept of recycling. I hope we'll be able to present the data next year. But this is still an ongoing question. What about the target? This is a very important concept. It's a concept of treat to target. Again, same concept as in rheumatoid arthritis. What's your aim? The aim is to avoid the development of complication and disability. The concept is to define, to predefine your target, which is associated with good long-term outcomes. What's the strategy? The strategy is monitoring the targets and using surrogate markers, optimize the treatment when the target is not met. And you have some additional principles. Of course, all components need to be tailored to individual needs. And maybe if the treat-to-target strategy is successful, then de-escalation may be considered. So in a nutshell, it's involving predefining treatments in consultation with the patients. The patient needs to be on board, needs to adhere to this concept, monitoring and changing the treatment as long as the target is not reached. What is the target? We don't know. Actually, this is just expert opinion. We believe that the target now has shifted from simple clinical remission to something which is more complex, which is clinical and endoscopic remission. Because we have a lot of retrospective data showing that endoscopic healing is associated with better long-term outcome. This is why in 2015, with the IYBD, we defined what are the recommendations for the target in Crohn's disease, which is a composite endpoint of clinical remission that needs to be assessed at a minimum of 3 months during active disease, and endoscopic remission, which is not very well defined. At that time, we said no ulceration. And this should be assessed as well within 6 to 9 months after starting. If endoscopy is not possible, you can do cross-sectional imaging. Biomarkers are not a target. They are tools for monitoring. Histology is not a target in Crohn's disease. In UC, same, clinical remission, no more rectal bleeding, and if possible, normalization of bowel habits. As far and as also endoscopic remission. At that time, we define as a Mayo endoscopic subscore or 0 or 1. Biomarkers, not a target. Histology, so far, not a target. But there is a strong push from some experts to reach this even further target and to reach for histological healing, because we have data showing that actually histological healing is associated with even better outcomes than endoscopic healing. But it's a tough target to reach. And of course, it needs to be individualized. If you have an early disease, you should be very ambitious. You want to bring your patients to a normal life. No symptoms, no progression, no disability. If it's a late stage disease, you will be happy if there is no progression of damage and improved quality of life. What about monitoring? This is also key. All therapeutic decisions in IBD need to be taken based on clinical symptoms and objective markers. Of course, it's difficult to repeat endoscopy. This is why the biomarkers are so important. This is a CALM study that we recently published in The Lancet, where we took naive patients, naive to immunosuppressors and biologics, started on prednisone, and after 9 months, they were randomized to a clinical management arm, where they were escalated only based on symptoms, and a tie control arm, where they were escalated based on symptoms and biomarkers. Meaning that even if the patient at different points in time was doing well, if the CRP or CALPRO was still high, he was escalated from no treatment, adalimumab every other week, every week, and eventually combo. And when the patient was doing well, he was able to de-escalate. I have no time to show all the data from this study, which is, I think, very rich, but I just want to show you the main endpoint, which was the target, endoscopic healing, and this was reached in 46% of the tie control arm as compared to 30% in the clinical management arm. Almost all secondary endpoints was met, and especially this very important endpoint of deep remission on the left-hand side, which is a combination of clinical and endoscopic remission. So this is the first study showing prospectively the importance of monitoring biomarkers in Crohn's disease. There will be a talk about drug monitoring as well, so I will not insist too much on that, but this is part of monitoring. There is a wealth of data, accumulating data, showing that with all biologics, there is an association between drug levels and clinical and endoscopic or even histological remission. This is true for infliximab, vedolizumab, adalimumab, ustekinumab. For instance, on the left-hand side, in the bottom, you can see that patients in mucosal healing on infliximab have higher trough levels, and same is true for adalimumab. But remember, all these studies are association studies. What about doing proactive monitoring versus reactive monitoring? So should we only measure levels when the patient is losing response or do proactive monitoring? This is the most convincing study for proactive monitoring, but this is a retrospective study done by Adam Scheifetz in the US, where they randomized patients between reactive monitoring or proactive, and actually proactive monitoring was associated with less treatment failure, less surgery, fewer antibodies, and less infusion reactions. But we have now 3 prospective studies, one from Denmark, one from Leuven, the TACSIT study, and the recent study from the JETED, which are prospective, doing proactive monitoring versus treatment based on symptoms, and the primary endpoint of those studies was negative. This is why we need more, and this is why the AGA actually doesn't recommend proactive monitoring in their guidelines. So there is more to do about that. Monitoring means also, especially when patients are living far, and I think you are very well advanced as far as this is concerned, doing, for instance, telemedicine or CALPRO monitoring at distance. This is a nice study from the Netherlands using a tool which is called My IBD Coach, which is a telemedicine tool, and this was a randomized trial. And those patients who were using telemedicine had fewer outpatient visits and fewer admissions to the hospitals. Even though the number of flares, emergency visits, and surgeries were similar. But I think this is a way to go. So this is my general thinking about UC or IBD. You need to define the target, to discuss the target with your patients, and you need to reach the target, and you need to use tight control so that you are never going outside the target. And this is a long journey. Finally, the right patients. It's very clear that, and we discuss as well about that, all patients are so heterogeneous. In your practice, you may see these green patients on the left side, which will never progress. We have Crohn's disease like that. And of course, you should avoid in this patient intensive treatment because you will overtreat these patients. On the other hand, you have these red patients who will be refractory to everything. And if I was able to detect that from the beginning, this patient will be on the most intensive treatment from the beginning. But how can I guess that? So far, it was just based on our clinical nose. But we have now some new tools coming. This is a tool from Corey Siegel, which is based on a new technique, which is system dynamic analysis. And basically, this is what is the result. So using the data from the model and this SDA, he has created this prospective tool. Basically, it takes into account the demographic of the patients, the phenotypes, the serological marker, and genetics. And then everything is put in the computer, and you can predict this curve. For instance, in this patient, the risk of progression is very high. And then this patient will merit intensive therapy from the beginning. So we have started to use this tool in clinical practice. And finally, the era of one drug fits all may be over. As you know, we have a lot of new targets and new therapies for IBD. On the wake of vedolizumab, new anti-leukocyte trafficking antibodies are developed. We have something which is called S1P receptor modulator ozanimod, same principle, blocking the lymphocytes in the lymph nodes. We have new anti-cytokine antibodies on the wake of ustekinumab, P19 antibodies, blocking IL-23, which look very promising. And we have all the family of JAK kinase inhibitor. First one, tofacitinib, I guess will be soon approved for UC, and there are more to come, filgotinib, upadacitinib. Unfortunately, we lost recently Mongersen, which was not effective in the phase 3 trial, and there is still a question mark about FMT. So how to choose between these drugs? Sorry, can I go? So how to choose? In my practice, I am always considering this. Efficacy, safety, practicality, and cost. What about efficacy? This is all the data about these drugs, and frankly, I can't conclude. And so far, there is no head-to-head trial. So based on efficacy, it's difficult to say. Based on safety, there is clear evidence that anti-adhesion molecules and ustekinumab are safer than anti-TNF. And then practicality, this is where the oral new drugs, such as the JAK kinase inhibitors, will be a big asset. And finally, what we hope to have soon are biomarkers. And we are doing a lot of work trying to find biomarkers. What does that mean? That means that you will measure a biomarker when you see your patient for the first time, and you will be able to say, like in oncology, this patient will respond to ustekinumab or will respond to Entyvio. This is a recent study with a P19 antibody showing that patients with high IL-22 levels in their blood, which is a line on the top, were responding much better than patients with low IL-22 in their blood. This may be one of the best examples of recent biomarkers, but still to be confirmed. So what's next? I must say that I don't believe so much in cure, which means no disease and no treatments. And we are now working a lot on a new concept, which may be too ambitious, which is prevention. Why is that? It's because in all immune diseases, there is a preclinical phase. On the right-hand side, you have the disease when it has started. But on the left-hand side, you have the genetic predisposition and environmental factors. And we know that before the first symptoms, there is already something occurring in the mucosa of the future patients. Change in the epithelial barrier, change in the tolerance to bacteria, change in innate or immune responses. And then this could pave the way for prevention. We reported last year, and we will present at DDW this year even more convincing data, a study that we have done with the Navy, with the Department of Defense in the US, showing that actually with a tool, this was just based on antimicrobial antibodies, you can predict the occurrence of IBD 5 years, 3 years, and 2 years, and 1 year before the first symptoms. And when you look at the area under curve, it's quite good. It's almost 0.8. And I think we can even improve this tool. So if this is confirmed, this could pave the way for prevention studies. Interventions to interrupt or prevent prevention to clinically apparent IBD may be implemented at multiple points along the pathway of disease development, when the disease has started, but maybe also before the disease has started. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Colombil.